In the last video, you saw what it might mean to learn a featureized representations of different words. In this video, you see how you can take these representations and plug them into NLP applications. Let's start with an example. Continuing with the named entity recognition example, if you're trying to detect people's names, give it a sentence like Sally Johnson is an orange farmer. Hopefully you figure out that Sally Johnson is a person's name. Hence the output's one like that. And one way to be sure that Sally Johnson has to be a person, rather than say the name of a corporation, is that, you know, orange farmer is a person. So previously we had talked about one hot representations to represent these words, x1, x2, and so on. But if you can now use the featureized representations, the embedding vectors that we talked about in the last video, then after having trained a model that uses word embeddings as the inputs, if you now see a new input, Robert Lin is an apple farmer, knowing that orange and apple are very similar will make it easier for your learning algorithm to generalize to figure out that Robert Lin is also a human, is also a person's name. One of the most interesting cases will be, what if in your test set you see not Robert Lin is apple farmer, but you see much less common words? What if you see Robert Lin is a durian cultivator? A durian is a rare type of fruit, popular in Singapore and a few other countries. But if you have a small label training set for the name entity recognition task, you might not even have seen the word durian or seen the word cultivator in your training set. I guess technically this should be a durian cultivator. But if you have learned a word embedding that tells you that durian is a fruit, so it's kind of like an orange, and a cultivator, you know, someone that cultivates, is kind of like a farmer, then you might still be able to generalize from having seen an orange farmer in your training set to knowing that a durian cultivator is also probably a person. So one of the reasons that word embeddings will be able to do this is the algorithms for learning word embeddings can examine very large text corpuses, maybe found off the internet. So it can examine very large data sets, maybe a billion words, maybe even up to 100 billion words would be quite reasonable. So very large training sets of just unlabeled text. And by examining tons of unlabeled text, which you can download, you know, more or less for free, you can figure out that orange and durian are kind of similar, and farmer and cultivator are kind of similar, and therefore learn embeddings that groups them together. Now, having discovered that orange and durian are both, you know, fruits by reading massive amounts of internet text, what you can do is then take this word embedding and apply it to your name entity recognition task, for which you might have a much smaller training set, maybe just 100,000 words in your training set, or even much smaller. And so this allows you to carry out transfer learning, where you take information you've learned from huge amounts of unlabeled text that you can suck down essentially for free off the internet to figure out that orange, apple, and durian are fruits, and then transfer that knowledge to a task such as name entity recognition, for which you might have a relatively small labeled training set. Oh, and of course, for simplicity, I drew this as a for and only, as a unidirectional RNN. If you actually want to carry out the name entity recognition task, you should, of course, use a bidirectional RNN rather than a simpler one I've drawn here. But to summarize, this is how you can carry out transfer learning using word embeddings. Step one is to learn word embeddings from a large text corpus, and this can be very large text corpora, or you can also download pre-trained word embeddings online. There are several word embeddings that you can find online under very permissive licenses. And you can then take these word embeddings and transfer the embedding to a new task where you have a much smaller labeled training set, and use this, let's say, 300-dimensional embedding to represent your words. One nice thing also about this is you can now use relatively lower dimensional feature vectors. So rather than using a 10,000 dimensional one hot vector, you can now instead use maybe a 300 dimensional dense vector. Although the one hot vector is sparse and the 300 dimensional vector, that you might learn for your embedding will be a dense vector. And then finally, as you train your model on your new task, on your name entity recognition task with a smaller label dataset, one thing you can optionally do is to continue to fine-tune, continue to adjust the word embeddings with the new data. In practice, you would do this only if your new task, only if this task 2 has a pretty big dataset. If your label dataset for step 2 is quite small, then usually I would not bother to continue to fine-tune the word embeddings. So word embeddings tend to make the biggest difference when the task you're trying to carry out has a relatively small training set. So it has been useful for many NLP tasks. Now just name a few. Don't worry if you don't know these terms, but it has been useful for name entity recognition, for text summarization, for code reference resolution, for parsing. These are all, maybe pretty standard NLP tasks. It has been less useful for language modeling and machine translation, especially if you're accessing a language modeling or machine translation task for which you have a lot of data just dedicated to that task. So as we've seen in other transfer learning settings, if you're trying to transfer from some task A to some task B, the process of transfer learning is just most useful when you happen to have a ton of data for A and a relatively smaller data set for B. And so that's true for a lot of NLP tasks and just less true for some language modeling and machine translation settings. Finally, word embeddings has an interesting relationship to the face encoding set of ideas that you learned about in the previous course, if you took the convolutional neural networks course. So you will remember that for face recognition, we trained this Siamese network architecture that would learn, say, a 128-dimensional representation for different faces, and then you could compare these encodings in order to figure out if these two pictures are of the same face. The words encoding and embedding mean fairly similar things. So in the face recognition literature, people also use the term encoding to refer to these vectors, fxi and fxj. One difference between the face recognition literature and what we do in word embeddings is that for face recognition, you wanted to train a neural network that can take as input any face picture, even a picture you've never seen before, and have a neural network compute an encoding for that new picture. Whereas what we'll do, which you understand this better when we go through the next few videos, whereas what we'll do for learning word embeddings is that we'll have a fixed vocabulary of, say, 10,000 words, and we'll learn a vector, E1 through, say, E10,000, that just learns a fixed encoding, or learns a fixed embedding for each of the words in our vocabulary. So that's one difference between the set of ideas you saw for face recognition versus what the algorithms will discuss in the next few videos. But the terms encoding and embedding are used somewhat interchangeably. So the difference I just described is not represented by the difference in terminology. It's just a difference in how we need to use these algorithms in face recognition, where there's an unlimited sea of pictures you could see in the future, versus natural language processing, where, there might be just a fixed vocabulary, and everything outside that will just declare as an unknown word. So in this video, you saw how using word embeddings allows you to implement this type of transfer learning, and how by replacing the one-hot vectors we're using previously with the embedding vectors, you can allow your algorithms to generalize much better, or even learn from much less labeled data. Next, I want to show you just a few more properties of these word embeddings, and then after that, we will talk about algorithms for actually learning these word embeddings. Let's go on to the next video, where you see how word embeddings can help with reasoning about analogies.